Let's bow our heads for prayer. Father, as we come before you this day, we come before a God and a Savior who understands us completely. And God, even though we may not always understand everything that takes place, we surely don't understand the why in many things. But God, we know that you sit on the throne and you are in authority. And therefore, everything you do, God, is for the betterment of your children and your church. And God, I pray today as these have come together to honor our dear brother, that God, Lord Father, as we are here, that you would touch their hearts and their lives. And Lord Father, you'd give strength unto this family in a special way. That God, you would lift them up, you would just touch them, and give them the comfort that is needed in these times that we are having to face. God, I pray that you'll just go with them after this time is finished. And God, Lord, you'll continue to let us know that Jesus is our help in the time of troubles. God, what you do, we'll praise you for it. And we thank you that we can call upon you in this hour. For we ask it all in Christ Jesus' name. Amen and amen. We're here to celebrate the homegoing of Paul Jackson Williams. Now, I never personally knew that that was his name. I knew Paul was his name, but I knew him as PJ. Amen. And so we come today and we're here to celebrate his homegoing, passing from this life into a better life. And there is no doubt, as a Christian, that's what we do. And I know that hurt is in this time of those that's left behind. And isn't it a reality that God tells us that we are to hurt? But we don't hurt with no hope. We're not as the world is, as a world that has no hope. Because even though we hurt, for a Christian to die, there's hope that we can be together again. So this family can lean on the reality that we have hope and we draw comfort from that. The Bible teaches us well in 2 Corinthians 1 and 3. Blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the Father of all mercy, and the God of all comfort. God's here to comfort us today. And we can lean on that comfort and pull to it as being a Christian and asking of the Lord to give us strength. He says in verse 4 of that scripture, who comforts us in all tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. I stand here in where that Danny and Linda stands today. I stood before in that same place, sat in the seat, where that I lost my dad, I lost my mama, and it hurt. I'm going to be honest with you, it hurt. But I had a God that came right on the spot during the time and comforted me, and he gave me strength through it. And I know that PJ would want you today to know that, you know, everything's okay. Don't worry about me. Everything's okay. So if we believe that we have hope for a Christian, and if PJ was a Christian as we know him to be, then we have hope we can see him again. One day we can be back together with him. And I believe that of Brother PJ, that as he has accepted Jesus many years ago, that now Jesus has accepted him into heaven. And that's the comfort that we hold to. Yes, there will be times when you will miss. You'll miss him. But then on that alone, we can look back to that time of relationship, them good times. Amen. Them times when we enjoyed the presence of him. Isn't it great that when we are separated for a short period, that our memories of him never leaves us? It stays with us all the way through. And you'll hear this word said even by Brother David Papa today. PJ was a good man. Yeah, he was a good man. I want to look a little bit as in the writings of his obituary. I'm not going to read them to you today. You have those where you can read them. But I definitely want to highlight them because of the accomplishment that this man had in his life. First of all, he was married to his wonderful wife, Marion, for 48 years. What an accomplishment. Amen. That's an accomplishment of life. That he knew and had his wonderful wife, and then he had his children, Linda and Danny, and then his, what was it, 9 grandchildren and 4 great-grands? What an accomplishment. And can I tell y'all that he loved you grandchildren? Amen. I know he loved y'all, Danny and Linda. I know he loved you, but I'm going to be honest with you. He probably loved those grandchildren more. Amen. Because he would brag on his children, but he really talked about those grandchildren in the last year that I've had a time to be around PJ. Amen. I'm glad I had that last year I've had with him too, because he would talk about them. And one of the last things he said to me in conversations, not the last time I talked with him, but in past conversation, he said that he was hoping he could go up one more time to y'all's home and be there. And we know that that's not going to be possible, but those memories can go back with you, and you can remember him. And so having a successful family is, it's a great part of life. It's good. And then I read there where he was a master sergeant in the United States Air Force. Served his country for 23 years. That alone is to be commended. That alone is to be praised, to the fact that he was willing to give his life to his country for 23 years. And in those 23 years, I noticed that he served 2 tours in Vietnam. That was no easy task. My brother served in Vietnam, and I know when he come back, when I was 15 years old, I know the hardship and the problems he dealt with, because I watched it in him. So I know that serving over there in that time of a war was not easy, no more than it is in this time we live in today when people are serving. So to be in the Vietnam War and then to be awarded and distinguished president unit citation and many other commendations speaks highly of him. And that is something to be recognized in a knowledge of a person's life. And I remember when we first got acquainted, I might talk about it more in just a second, first got acquainted with PJ, he told me a lot about his military experience. Because all of you know, PJ loved to talk. He loved to talk. And he told me back when I was his pastor at Saucus Tea and first met PJ, he told me about his distinguished of his, not, he never told me about his medals. I did not know that till I read them. But he told me about some of the ways and the work he did and working on airplanes and how that when they were working on airplanes, they'd get bombed there in the area where they were working on them in Vietnam. And he dealt with that. And he carried his life on through it. And he did it because one of his greatest accomplishments in life is he met Jesus Christ. Now, I tried to find out, and I didn't find out for a surety, how long PJ, or when PJ got saved, but I know for personal facts he was a Christian over 40 years. Because it was about that time that I got to know him down at Saucus Tea. I can even relate to the fact that the first time I known this family, PJ and invited us over to eat oysters. I remember it clearly, Mary, when we went to y'all's house at Saucus Tea, and yeah, we roasted oysters. If I remember right, it was on a tin thing outside on a fire. And I remember that. But this is the type of person he was. He said, Pastor, I want you to come over and eat oysters with us. Well, you don't have to ask me twice to eat oysters. I'll show up if you got oysters. But I did find out in this family, some of them can eat oysters more than me. So I ain't going to call no names. But they can eat oysters more than me. PJ was not only a good family man, a wonderful person to our country to serve, but he was also a wonderful neighbor. He was. And PJ had a little nick about him that I blame this to military. I could be wrong, because I've seen other military people want this way. But I know that shine, and I've met other military people that retired in the military that was that way. But when you were doing something, it had to be done a certain way. But what I love about PJ, even though he would tell you how to be done, he wouldn't harp on you that you had to do it that way. Just the other day, we was up there and we was working on, I forgot what it was. It'll come to me in a minute. We were working on something. Me and Casey was working on something, and he stopped in, and he said, well, this is the way you need to do that. And he told us how we're supposed to do it. Well, when he finished talking, he didn't say nothing else. And so Casey was doing the work actually at the time, and so Casey just went ahead and did it the way he was doing it to begin with. But he was that type of person. He didn't do that to irritate you or to be ill or tell you he knows more. He was doing that to help you. And I'm going to tell you from a man's point of view, that can irritate you. There's nothing irritating a man more than his wife trying to tell him how to do something. And then for a neighbor to come and try to tell him, it bothers him a little bit too. But PJ didn't do it to irritate. PJ done it because he wanted to help. That was PJ. That's the man I've known. And a man I know that you knowed. He had a good heart. Such a good heart that I've seen him in the last year running his tractor by the house. And he would stop there with his tractor when he was coming back. And I'd say, PJ, what you been up to? Well, the neighbor down the road needed something done, and I wanted to help him. That was PJ. You tell me that isn't a good person. Had a heart of gold. Would help you any way he could. And expect no help in return. Now, I'm talking about the man I knew. Y'all know him a lot better than I did. Because I've been gone from him for 20 years to where I got back in 21. And it's like I'd never been gone with PJ. He just come right back in as a friend to me. Wanted, I could sit up here, and I'm sure Preacher David's going to tell you some things about him that he has done, but I'm not going to do it, my part of that. But I can tell you things he's done for me that has been appreciated. They have been appreciated. PJ also loved to tell jokes. If you've been around him, he loved to tell jokes. But I got to say, my favorite joke PJ ever told me, and y'all know what I'm talking about because I know he's told you, is about the Christian dog. Now, I have to admit, I have took PJ's joke because he's the first one ever told me. And I have told it in North Carolina and in Tennessee, as well in South Carolina, because I loved it. Good joke. Good, clean, Christian joke. I'm not going to tell it to you today, even though I want to. I'm not. Because PJ, I know he's told you that. A few weeks ago, PJ called me out of the blue. Kathy was there at the house, and well, maybe she wasn't in the house. He called me one other time. He called me, I think it was just last week, but this was another time, I think. He called me, and he asked me a question I didn't think too much about at the time, just PJ's curiosity. You know how he was. If he got something on his mind, he wanted to find out about it. And PJ called me. He said, Preacher, I want to ask you a question. I said, what's that? He said, you know how I am. I get to thinking on things I want an answer. He said, what are they doing in heaven? I didn't understand it then. But I understand it now. Do I think he knew he was fixing to go to heaven? I don't really think he knew. But it was on his mind. He could have known. That could have been why he refused to go to the doctor. He could have known. But I do know just the other week he called me and asked me about that. And I explained it to him the best of what I believed. And I said, PJ, that's what I believe. He said, well, you help me. He said, you know how I am. I'm just curious and wanted to know. I've thought about that since Monday. I still don't know exactly what they're doing in heaven. But PJ does now. He does now. He knows what they're doing. I wish I could talk to him and ask him, because I could hear him say, "Preacher, let me tell you." That's the way he was. I'm going to read you the Lord's in Psalms 23, the psalmist. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." He's with Jesus today. And if there's any comfort to be known, know this. He's enjoying where he's at. Because he's in the greatest place a person can be. I've said this before about people, and I say it about PJ today. He's made it where I long to go. God bless you.
How great thou art. I'd like to thank everyone for coming out today to show your last respects to Brother PJ and to showing your love for this family. I'd like to thank Johnson's Funeral Home for what they have done. Also, I'd like to thank the military for being here today, and my condolences to the family. We love Brother PJ. It is my honor to stand up here today. And I want to say it's not just my honor, but it's easy to stand up here. It's easy because Brother PJ made it easy. Because he promised me he was ready to go to heaven a long time ago. And that makes it easy on me knowing where he's at. And I'm also got to be honest today, amen, because I knew him well. And Brother Danny and Linda, I'm going to tell you a few things about your daddy that I just knew him well. Miss Marion, and he was a friend of mine, amen. I want to start off by saying he was a friend of mine, and the Bible says this, for a man that hath friends, he must show himself friendly, amen. And PJ was just that. The first time I ever talked to him, felt like I've known him all my life. And, of course, he had to slip in about two or three jokes before it was over with, amen. And sometimes he would tell me jokes, and I'd say, you remember I'm the preacher, right? But they were still all right. They wasn't that bad. But we had a good time. He was my friend. Amen. The last time I was at his house, not the last time, but the time before, I brought a fellow from the church here that never met him before, and we was trying to get out the door for about 20 minutes, and he was like, one more thing, and so the younger fellow that was with me when we left, here's what he said. He sure was a friendly fellow, wasn't he? Say amen. That was him. He was a friendly fellow. Amen. He had his jokes, and it made him friendly. And he was friendly enough to teach you something. Amen. We had a few things in common. Tractors was one of them. And he'd come to the house, and I was loading up, I forget what it was. It might have been a disc on it, and I was struggling. He said, let me show you how to make that easy on you, son. And so before we got done, he had showed me completely how to hook up a disc right by yourself without any help. And he did that all the time. And I'd hear that diesel coming down the driveway. Many, many a times he had stopped by my house, Sister Mary, and he'd run into town for something, and he'd stop by my house. Now, I lived in town, Aynor, there, right across from the grocery store, the IGA. And one day he come up, and his back seat was full of pork. It was full of pork. I'm talking about sliced at half inch thick, half, the good pork chops, you know what I mean? And he said, I got you something in the back of the seat, preacher. And I looked back there, and it was full. And it wasn't just a bag or two bags. It was probably 75, 80 pounds of pork. And he said, they just had it on sale, IGA, and I thought, whatever I got me, I'd get you. And I said, this much meat? My wife said, we're going to have high blood pressure eating all this pork. And I said, so they had it on sale right across the street? He said, no, it was in Loris, but I thought I'd bring it to you anyway. That was a friend. Amen. That was a friend. He also, 2 Corinthians, I wanted to read this scripture to us. And the Bible says, every man according to he has purposed in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly, nor of necessity, but God loves a cheerful giver. Not only was he friendly, but he was a giver. Brother PJ was a giver. And I don't mean one of them type, here's a $100 bill, I hope it makes it better. I'm talking about a giver. Yes. There's some things I cannot tell about that I have seen him do. And he was a giver. Very few people I've ever seen that could come close to being a giver like Brother PJ was. When he knew there was a need, he was giving. Amen. He was a giver. He gave me all those meats, any kind of meats, any kind of needs he would know about. He would say, preacher, he'd come by the house. I want to help out on that. I want to help out. And he was a giver. Also, I seen that in his obituary that as well. He talked about the military a little bit with me, not much. But I read in there that he also served our country. And I thought, here goes a man now who is friendly, who is a giver, and he's also a server. Yeah. A server. He served in the military 23 years and two tours in Vietnam. Master Sergeant. I don't know exactly what class that is, but it sounds big. Yeah. And knowing the way he was, he's probably a good master sergeant. And it's just a blessing. If I could say anything to Brother Danny or Linda, if you could learn anything from your daddy, be friendly. Be a giver. Be a servant. There was another person that reminded me of, and it was our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That's who Brother PJ reminded me of, minus the jokes. He reminded me so much of our Lord. He was a friend. He was a giver. And he was a server. And I'll always remember him like that, Sister Mary. I'll always remember. I'm gonna miss that truck pulling up. I'm going to miss my meat. Somebody else has got to do that. And I'm going to miss Brother PJ. I'm going to miss it. I love you, family. You had a daddy you could be proud of. I mean that. Sister Marion, we love you as well. May God bless you.
All my words fall short. I got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end.
Let's pray. Father, we come in the name of Jesus, and we thank you, Lord. Though our hearts are heavy, we are still comforted, O God, by your word, and by the memories, and by your grace, God. We thank you, Lord, today that you are with us, and I pray for this family, God. Help them today and the days ahead and even weeks. And when everyone's gone, God, that's when you can pull up beside them and give them that peace and comfort. And I pray for them, Jesus, Lord, that you'll touch them and help them minister into their soul. And help us now, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. This will conclude this part of the service. The military will present their presentation now, and they will have a gun salute, so just be prepared for this.